Well, shalom Torah fans. Welcome back to our Wednesday night Bible study here at the Aviv Moon Production Studio and the Rood Awakening headquarters. As you can see, the tour is over. What a whirlwind, ladies and gentlemen. It has been nonstop. Passover, just 2 days after Passover, got on the plane, took off to Israel. Then just a few days later, met the entire tour group. Again, another archaeological extravaganza of apocalyptic proportions in the land of Israel. And now the tour is over and we're back in the saddle. And thank you for joining us for what is going to be the end of section one of the 10-part sections of the Chronological Gospels. And what we are going to do is finish up this section, and then next time we are together, we're going to start section two, which is on section two, dealing with from the mikvah to Passover preparations in Yeshua's ministry. So this is going to take care of the origin, the birth, and the childhood of Yeshua, Yohanan, and take us all the way through to the end of that particular section, ending with a summary statement, which is really a summary of Yeshua's entire childhood until the day that he is mikvahed. And we're going to see the importance of that in the course of this. You hear so many people say, well, what did Yeshua do when he was this old? There are a couple of books called The Infancy 1 and 2, which are in the collection of the lost books of the Bible. Again, these are some extra biblical texts, some old books that when you read them, you know that this is just pure nonsense that is made up. And I can probably quote some of it to you so that you understand how ridiculous some of these extra biblical texts are, such as the Chaldean astronomers. The astronomers get to Bethlehem on the very day that Yeshua is born, and they go to the high priest of the synagogue at Bethlehem and ask where the child is. And of course, he sends them to a manger, or excuse me, it's not even a sukkah manger, it's it's where they keep animals. And so as soon as you read it, you know, this was written by a complete idiot, because there is no high priest of a synagogue. This is a Pharisee enclave. This is not even the bailiwick of the priest. The priests serve in the temple. These are the sons of Zadok or the Zadokim. They're not in charge of, it's like going to a Baptist church in the South and asking where the Pope is. The Pope ain't gonna be there because the Pope is not part of that system. So as soon as you read something like this, you know it's ridiculous. Here's another one from infancy, that Yeshua has a dispute with one of his teachers, and so he strikes him dead. Another time, Yeshua is sailing a little boat in a puddle, and he sinks, he gets mad at the other boys and sinks all their other boats. You know, you read this stuff and you think, you know, what kind of idiot wrote this? And you know, it's in a collection of lost books of the Bible. that's another sign that we're really dealing with just a world of fairy tales, ladies and gentlemen. Where we get the truth is in the biblical record, and we need to keep going over this in detail to where we can see how all the details fit together, because it is in chronology that we have cause and effect. Without the time-ordered sequence of event, there is no cause and effect. We have basically numbered sound bites that can be isolated from the context and are all the time. That's why you have, 30,000 plus denominations, is they just isolate numbered sound bites, interpret them according to what they don't understand, or interpret them in the light of their modern culture instead of it being an Eastern book and a Hebrew culture. And so you end up with some very bizarre stuff out there. And so that is why we take the time to go through the Gospels, we go through the order of things chronologically so that we can see cause and effect, because right here in the very beginning, the very first section, the origin, birth, and childhood of Yeshua and Yohanan, we see details come to light that without having it in ordered sequence, we never even let those pictures cross our mind. But we have to remember that the Gospel records is a screenplay. And if we have, if we understand the screenplay as the story is being told, and then it stops, and then it goes back and tells another piece of the story, and then it goes forward, and then the two stories join together, and then it moves, and then it stops, and then we have another piece of the story told. If we see that, because that's a part of you know, most good movies, is that they're filling in details from different points in time that finally everything comes together. And, you know, I've seen some absolute brilliant movies that the very opening of the movie, that first scene plays, and then everything else starts out 3 days before and brings you up to that moment, and then that moment lasts for 2 minutes, and the whole story is told just like that. And so if we understand the Gospel records as four individual authors telling their individually inspired perspectives, and they're showing different facets of the Messiah and his life and what is transpiring, and then we have the Roman records, the historical records, everything added into it, that is what we're coming up with to come to the final concluding statement of Yeshua's childhood. So what I'd like you to do, first of all, is we're gonna start out by stepping back into I-2. This is index, page 2. This is the chronology of the Gospels, life and ministry, 70-week ministry of the Messiah, the origin, birth, and childhood of Yeshua and Yohanan. And what I wanna do with you is something that I do myself frequently. I just go through the index. I read the index because what I'm doing when I do that is I'm watching the movie play out in my mind, and I see things in order, and things begin to fill in. And so please go along in this journey with me as we pick up the Gospel record, and we're going to see that the Gospel of Luke, as it says, that this Luke has had understanding from the very beginning, and he puts things in chronological order. And so having the chronology of Luke, where it shows Yeshua as the Son of Man, this is what begins to play out, and very seldom are we even interrupted with anything out of any other gospel except for Matthew. Just occasionally, a verse or a portion or a few verses that add in a little bit of detail, but it is really Luke that sets the whole standard on it, until we come to the astronomers who come from Babylon to the house where the young child is, and they arrive 1 year, 2 months, and 6 days after the birth of Yeshua. But all the previous stuff was covered by Luke. So step back with me, and we are going to see this very thing as it plays out. The origin, birth, and childhood of Yeshua and Yohanan. This is our introduction, and as we see, as we got into it, we saw that John starts out the earliest day, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him. Without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men, and the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. The same came for a witness to bear witness of the light. He was not that light, he was sent to bear witness of the light that all men through him might believe. That was the true light, the light of every man that comes into the world. I think I memorized that probably in fifth grade, and it's still there. And you know, that's why it's important to memorize the scripture, because someday we will be without it. But this starts way back in the beginning, before time begins. In the beginning was the Word. But, and now when we get into the detail of the background, again, first of all, the very first thing we saw was, note one, the relevance of the creator's calendar and the timing of the Feast of Yahweh in the gospel narrative. The biblical calendar, based on the sighting of the first sliver of the new moon to begin the month, the aviv barley in the land of Israel to begin the year, barley being a phototropic spring crop, which ripens according to the amount of rain that it begins not to receive after the wet season, and the amount of sunlight that it receives in the spring, we know that every year will be the beginning of the year. It's going to begin at a different time than it does on the pagan calendar, but even the Babylonian calendar begins in the spring of the year. It's called Nisan, as Israel, or as the Jews were in Babylon, it was called Nisan, the beginning of the year. But every calendar has the beginning of the year. It's basically in the spring of the year. The Romans got it in the wintertime a little bit. But on the biblical calendar, a year is a year is a year. There's no such thing as a 360 day year compared to a 364 and a quarter day year. These things are really artificially man-made, and nothing can be figured out by using, you know, the amount of days in a year, because literally there are no 360 day years. It could be 354 days in a biblical year, it could be 382, could be anything in between. There may be a strange year in which you might actually have 360 days in the year. It's basically a mathematical framework. To those who know how the calendar works, the creator's calendar, it gives you the correct passage of time. But there's never consistent 30-day months. There's never 1,260 days in 3.5 years. There's never 42 months in 3.5 years. And to say that this is because of Velikovsky's Worlds in Chaos, that it was once 360-day years, it's not necessary. There's just no evidence that there ever was a 360 day year. It is a linguistic device to show the passage of time. And we know that in three and a half years, there's always gonna be an eight Arbat, there's always gonna be a 13th month, there's never gonna be just 42 months in 3.5 years, etc. Never be 1,260 days in 3.5 years. It's a linguistic device to let us know this. So we have to understand the creator's reckoning of time. We have to understand the feast of the Lord, which are the Moedim, which are governed by the creator's passage of time. Once we have that, then we can have the entire framework of the gospel record. Because the gospels show Yeshua going up to each one of the feasts. He goes up and either fulfills the feast or he interprets the feast. And he's either coming back from the feast, going up to the feast, at the feast. You know, this is the biblical record. It's the reckoning of time. And this is why it's so absolutely important. The creator's calendar that we, producing this every year now, as I've done it for well over 20 years, this is absolutely paramount for us to understand the biblical record. Because without understanding the Feast of the Lord in the first century, the years in which it took place, you can never figure out anything. And it took over 30 years of diligent work to be able to have these calculations to where we can actually produce them. Robert Scott Wadsworth, the author of Voice Cry in the Heavens, Robert Scott Wadsworth, he was the one that helped so much in the restoration of the biblical calendar through the years, and the untold hundreds of man hours that went into this. The people that want to poo-poo the calendar are the ones that usually spent like 5 minutes reading something one day. It's not someone that spent 30 years working on it. So our first note, the relevance of the creator's calendar and the timing of the Feast of Yahweh, absolutely imperative. And then we start out with the very first incident. Zechariah serves in the temple according to the order of Aviah, which is the eighth course, which begins on the Sabbath. and begins and ends on Shabbat. Every course begins and ends. And this gives us the timing of when Zechariah is in the temple, because Zechariah is chosen to burn incense on the altar of incense for the first and only time in his life. And that is when the angel Gabriel is sent to make the announcement. And that is incident two, Gabriel's announcement to Zechariah that Elisheva will have a son. That transpires on Shavuot, Pentecost. At the time, there's a great multitude outside at the time of incense praying. He then is confronted by the angel and told that he will have a son. He says, how am I gonna know this? And the angel said, well, I'm Gabriel. I stand in the presence of Almighty God. I've been sent to give you this message, but somehow that's not good enough for you. Okay, look, you're gonna be deaf and not able to speak until all these things come to pass. Zechariah walks out of the temple, opens his mouth to pronounce the Aaronic blessing. Nothing comes out of his mouth. Everyone is stymied. They're confused. What in the world's happened? He's been in there so long, they think, has he seen a vision? What's happened? Now he comes out and is unable to speak. Zechariah goes home. Incident number four, returns home on the first day of the week after the final Shabbat service of his order is concluded. This is gonna be the 15th day of the third month. Happens to be June 10th of 4 BC. That's on a Sunday morning. He heads back to his home. And then soon after that, in the Rosh Chodesh, the head of the month, that's when Elisheva conceives a son. And then it's in the sixth month with Elisheva that after she conceives, that Gabriel announces to Miriam that she is going to conceive by the Holy Spirit and she is going to bear the Son of the Most High. That transpires on the last day of Hanukkah. We see that the Almighty is consistently, throughout the biblical record, he is fulfilling his feast, these prophetic shadow pictures of good things to come, and it's going down according to his feast, his reckoning of time, these prophetic shadow pictures that have been put in place. And here, the last day of the Feast of Hanukkah, the eighth day, which the eighth is new beginning, we see that is when the announcement is made. And it is going to then, from that time, and 9 months later, is then going to wind us up at the Feast of Tabernacles. Now, we are going to then see incident number seven, because when Miriam says, well, how am I gonna know this? I'm a virgin, I've not known a man. And the angel said, well, how are you gonna know this? Your cousin, Elisheva, you know, the one that everyone calls barren, the old lady, the old barren one, it's now in her, she's in her sixth month. And so it says that Miriam, incident seven, hastily departs to see the sign promised by Gabriel. And so she gets down, travels all the way down to the Jerusalem area. And this is where Elisheva and Yohanan are living. And as soon as she comes into the courtyard, Elisheva comes out, 6 months pregnant, the old woman 6 months pregnant. And as soon as she sees Miriam, she said the babe leaped in her womb. She started prophesying that which is told to Miriam by the angel will certainly come to pass. And what is this that the mother of my Lord should come unto me? And that prophecy must have just rung in her ears. I can imagine Miriam just falling to the ground, just weeping, realizing that this thing that was told to her by the angel is really, 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 really real. What an awesome realization. How many doubts as she traveled the 3 days plus to get down to see her cousin, and then to see her walk out and her belly is out there, absolutely incredible. And then we come to the birth of the son of Zechariah and Elisheva. He is born on the high Sabbath of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the day that we set a place for Elijah at the Passover table. That's when the prophet who came in the spirit of Elijah came on that day. Again, that prophetic shadow picture put in place. Then we have the Brit Milah, 8 days later, the naming of Zechariah Jr., which no, Elisheva says his name shall be called Yohanan. And as soon as Zechariah, who motioned for the writing state, writes his name, as soon as he writes Yohanan, boom, His ears were open, his mouth was open, and he let roar prophecy. The people said, what manner of child is this going to be? And then we have the summary of Zechariah ben Yochanan's first 27 years, where he is survives by being led by the Spirit from his mother's womb, living out in the desert until the day of his showing forth to Israel. One of the summary statements, the verse summary statement in the book of Luke. Then we have inserted, I've inserted the genealogy of Yeshua. Yeshua through his Miriam, his mother, whose father is Yosef ben Yaakov from the royal line of King David through Solomon. And then we have Luke's, I bring back Luke's insertion of the genealogy of Miriam's husband, whose his name is also Yosef, but it's Yosef ben Eli, who is a relative of King David through one of David's other sons, Nathan. So Miriam and Yosef, her espoused husband, they're both related to King David. You have to go all the way to King David to find the link because they're two different sons' lineages that come out of there. Then we have the marriage of Yosef and Yosef ben Eli and Miriam bat Yosef. It's legally finalized but not consummated until after Yeshua is born. That is detailed in the first chapter of Matthew. And then we get into the detail line by line of the chronology of Yeshua's birth. First of all, with the decree of Caesar Augustus that all the subjects of the empire were required to register their support for naming Octavius Augustus the father of the Roman Empire in the 25th year of his reign, which is 3 to 2 BC, and that is the time that Yosef will register with Rome in Beit Lechem at his convenience during the Feast of Tabernacles when he takes Miriam, who is well with child, up to Jerusalem. And then we have the first of seven conjunctions that appears on August 1st to 3 BC. This is when the Chaldean astronomers first observe his star in the east, and they are watching because they are going to see seven conjunctions of his star. The righteous king, the line of the tribe of Judah, is going to be announced in the heavens, and the Chaldean astronomers, who are the descendants of the Chaldean astronomers that were under the training and the direction of Daniel, who now have Daniel's treasure, now 600 years later, are watching the heavens for these signs so they will know when to deliver the gifts of Daniel and the provisions for the king of Israel. And then we have the next, the second conjunction, transpiring on September 12th of 3 BC, and then Yosef and Miriam go up to Jerusalem for the Feast of Sukkot. And the second conjunction is the great sign in the heavens that is spoken of in the book of the Revelation. The new moon between the feet of Betula, the stars above her head, the constellation Aryeh, the lion of the tribe of Judah, that is when Hatzedek comes into conjunction with Amalek. The announcement of the birth of the righteous king, the lion of the tribe of Judah, is made on Tishri 1. And then Miriam and Yosef go up to Jerusalem for the Feast of Sukkot. They also register for the Roman decree in the nearby village of Beit Lechem. And that is when the word is made flesh and tabernacled among us. And then we have 8 days later, which happens on the first day of the Feast of Sukkot, which is a high Sabbath. Then on the last day, which is a high Sabbath, Yeshua is circumcised. And Yeshua refers to this later. He says, you get on me for healing a man on the Sabbath, yet you will circumcise a child on the 8th day so that the Torah of Moses is not broken. He was literally circumcised on a high Sabbath, so that the Torah is not broken, because that circumcision takes precedent over every other thing that takes place. And so then it says that we have the next incident, Yeshua is redeemed in the temple, Miriam's purification offering, and Yeshua's redemption with the poor man's offering on his 40th day, and that is when Shimon, a prophet, and Hannah, a prophetess, both prophesy at the time of his dedication, and then the news starts to go out around Jerusalem because they are well-known prophets. She is a prophetess well up in years, and she's in the temple every day telling people about the king has come. The king is here. She's seen him. And Shimon has prophesied as well. And then we have the summary statement from Luke that after the Torah commandments are fulfilled, they remain in Bethlehem for a year and over 2 months until the Chaldean astronomers get there. And then finally, after going down into Egypt and then coming back, they go home to, instead of Beit Lechem, they know there's trouble, and so they go up into the north and finally settle back in Nazareth. Now we come to the third conjunction of his star, the incident on page 54, and then the fourth conjunction, the fifth, the sixth, the seventh conjunction, and after the seventh conjunction, that is when the astronomers leave Babylon and head for Jerusalem. And then incident number 20, the Chaldean astronomers arrive in Jerusalem. They meet with Herod on the sixth day of the week. They rest on the Sabbath. They have a dream, receive that warning. Then it is the very next day that on Sunday morning in their pre-dawn observations, they see his star in the rising in retrograde standing directly over Bethlehem, Hatzedek in conjunction with the Moloch directly over Bethlehem that can be seen, calculated right from Jaffa Gate today, which is Herod's citadel. That's what they see. They rejoice with great joy. They present their gifts to the king and then depart another way. That night, Yosef has a dream. He gets up in the middle of the night. They pack their trash. They head down to Egypt. And then, incident 24, Herod then orders, when he finds out that the Chaldean astronomers are left, gone another way, he then orders all the children to be slaughtered. 2 years and under, according to the time, he diligently inquired of the wise men. And so then, they are specifically looking for Yohanan ben Zachariah. So I gave the detail last time about Herod sending the temple guard going out to Zachariah's house. He's not there. And according to the proto-evangelion of James, one of these Latin texts, it says that Zachariah's in the temple serving, that Elisheva takes Yohanan, who is now about a year and 8 months old, takes him out into the wilderness, disappears. The guard comes back to Zechariah, slaughters him, kills him. His blood runs between the altar and the temple. Yeshua refers to it later in both Luke and Matthew, 2 days before his execution on the 23rd, on the 13th, the 13th day of the month of the Aviv, that's when he refers to all the responsibility for the righteous bloodshed from Abel to Zechariah, who you slaughtered between the altar and the holy place. He's speaking of his uncle, Zechariah, the Cohen, okay? And so then there is another astronomical observation, the lunar eclipse that marks Herod's execution of two Pharisee rabbis, and that is followed shortly thereafter by Herod's death. Herod dies. Yosef is commanded to return to Israel. At that time, when he gets up there, he finds out that Archelaus is ruling in the place of his father, and according to Josephus, Archelaus sends in the Roman cavalry, slaughters 3,000 Pharisees on the Temple Mount just before Passover starts. Then they send out the Roman legions throughout the camp of Israel with hundreds of thousands there. And he says, all but the stupidest, even the dumbest people knew that nobody was gonna be having Passover. They weren't willing to risk their life, so everyone left. Passover was canceled that particular year. Now we see that Archelaus is called up to Rome by Caesar to answer for his deeds and the unstabilizing action. And at that time, General Verus, comes out of Syria to put down the Jewish rebellion, and now we are all the way to where we want to start with the very last incident in Yeshua's childhood. And before we do, we're gonna take a break and allow you to be a part of this ministry by staying with this ministry financially, because finances is what it takes for us to do what we do to get out to the world. Here's your 2 minutes. Stand with us, pray with us, get on the phone, commit, stand. Please become a member of the Ambassador Club so we can depend on you. Because when we make our commitments, when we sign our contracts, that's when the broadcasters depend upon us to keep our word. So help me help you. Help me help the world. Help me make these last months and years the best that can possibly be for the getting the gospel of the kingdom out to the world. Thank you.
God don't make promises that he don't keep. You got some big dreams, baby, but in order to dream, you gotta still be asleep. When you gonna wake up? You tied up into knots. When you gonna wake up? When you gonna wake up? When you gonna wake up? Strengthen the things that remain. You got innocent men in jail. Your insane asylums are filled. You got unrighteous doctors kill your ills. When you gonna wake up? When you gonna wake up? When you gonna wake up? Strengthen the things that remain. You got men who can't hold their peace, women who can't control their tongue. The rich seduce the poor, and the old are seduced by the young.
I appreciate all of you standing with this ministry, and I'm doing this Wednesday night Bible study for our Aviv fellowships, our Guardians of the Aviv, who are scattered all over the world, literally now hundreds of Aviv fellowships all over the planet. We know we have people that are up in the middle of the night in the east watching this. I know I get reports every week of people that are in Israel that stay up all night and watch the program. People over in India and Pakistan, it seems other parts of the world, you know, they are so dedicated to get this to happen. They get together with friends and family, call everyone together right in the middle of the night to watch this. Thank you, thank you, thank you for being with us. And I do know how precious this is. I know that a lot of you have to do this in secret. And here in America, it's almost, you know, it's leisure time. But, you know, we do appreciate, because the Almighty knows what you're putting into it, and he will reward you accordingly. You know, what you sow, you reap. And when you sow in tears and you sow in stress, you know that you're going to reap abundantly. If we sow at our leisure, then it's just kind of leisurely comes to us here. But You know, that's why we push. We push hard. We're pushing right at the edge of the envelope all the time. We are doing as much as we can to afford to get out to as many people as possible. And as people stand with us, as they join the Ambassador Club, making that commitment to us to send in at least $100 a month, that gives us the opportunity, and we push it out the door to the other side to get it out to more and more people right out the other side, because we know our time is limited. And here it is now, you know, just a month and a year after my open heart surgery. And I really look at it as that, you know, I am living on time that the Almighty has granted me some extra of. And thanks to all of you who stood with me and helped to finance the surgery. You know, I'm in there, I'm fighting. You know, help me. Continue to stand with me and help me to make this thing happen. I want to talk to you about our monthly love gift. This month, the Feast of Matzah. This is, of course, the month in which Passover transpired. And so this is where I get to take you to the Feast of Matzah, eradicating the leaven, and give you the background of what Yeshua is doing in the temple when he actually overturns the money changers and drives the animals out, breaks open the cages, lets the doves go free. What is he doing by this? And what is the message? This is so important, and I'm so thankful that I got to focus in on just this. Now, ladies and gentlemen, this is part of the 20-month series. It's all one package. Stand with us every single month. Get this and digest it, learn it. Because I'm not gonna be able to do it any other way. This is not gonna be on YouTube. It's not gonna be available any other way. This is how it's available to you as a monthly love gift. So please stand with me. And this is my gift to you as you stand with me to help me in the ministry. Also, the Jonah Code is also part of this month's love gift. And you'll see the detail in this as we go to that. But the Jonah Code, the 10-hour video series, this details with the chronology of Yeshua's life and ministry. It teaches you how to count to 3. It teaches you how to count to 70 and get the calculations right. As the scripture says, prove all things, hold fast to that which is true. And when we prove all things, that's mathematics, ladies and gentlemen. It's a mathematical proof. Everything has to add up. So that is what we are, that's what we're doing here. Our health conference, our first ever health awakening conference right here is going at our headquarters in Charlotte, North Carolina, is going to be featuring Dr. Scott Laird. This is his bailiwick, ladies and gentlemen, in his most brilliant work on GMOs. Hopefully he's going to be getting more into that. We also have Paul Nissan. So this is where you go. Register for it. Go to roodhealth.com. That's roodhealth.com, and register for this conference. Don't miss this very exciting adventure that we are going to be on. Some of the photos from Israel tour, watch for them. Take a look up on the website. Just finished up right now, so you know we'll get those up so that you can see a little bit about it. Make your plans for next year. Don't know yet if we're gonna be able to go. You know, things are, you know, getting very wild in the world out there, but we're gonna do what we can to minister and to take people for advanced Hanukkite warrior training to Israel as long as we possibly can. So we'll be back with the rest of the teaching right after this word for our sponsors, which happen to be you out there. See you in a minute. When you gonna wake up?
Deceived by the leaven of their greed, the Pharisees allowed money changers to conduct business at the temple until Yeshua wielded a whip and eradicated their leaven for the Feast of Matzah. Get to know the story behind Yeshua's cleansing of the temple in Michael Rood's brand new teaching, The Feast of Matzah.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is the first time, the first of many times. As a matter of fact, Yeshua is going to repeat this prophecy more than any other thing.
This month, for your love gift donation of $50 or more, Michael Rood will send you this brand new teaching. It's not for sale and it won't be on YouTube. The only way you can get it is with your love gift donation in April. Plus, if you give a donation of $100 or more, we'll send you the Feast of Matzah plus one of Michael Rood's most popular teaching series of all time, the Jonah Code. Don't miss your chance. Act now to receive the Feast of Matzah collection.
The lives of Israeli victims hang critically in the balance following events of terror, violence, and war. But there's another painful problem: men, women, and children living in poverty. And you can be there for them. Visit us online at thelydiaproject.com. You'll find personal stories from the people who need you and the information you need to make a difference in their lives. When you give to the Lydia Project, you enable us to send help. Emotional and spiritual encouragement are especially needed during these critical days of recovery. Your support enables our ground team in the land of Israel to function as Yehovah intended, providing for the wounded soldiers, widows, orphans, and the poor. Help Israel. Give to the Lydia Project.
Now, as we go into this final section, I want to step back to get a running start on it to Incident 25, which is on page 60. And this is where the incident is a spring of 4,000 from the common era. It's 1 BC. And this is Herod dies and Yosef is commanded to return to Israel. In Matthew chapter 2, verse 19, we read, "When Herod was dead, the angel of Yahweh appeared in a dream to Yosef in Egypt, saying, 'Rise up, take the young child and his mother and return to the land of Israel, for those who sought the child's life are dead.'" And that was Herod specifically. And he was the one that ordered the slaughter of the innocent children 2 years and under, according to the time he diligently inquired of the wise men. And then we see that the note number 4, appearing right after this, the top of page 61, is Archelaus rules in his father's place. And in the Antiquities of the Jews, this is what Josephus wrote. Archelaus thought the whole situation impossible to salvage except by checking the crowd's impulse to such a thing, this revolt. So he sent out his whole army, including the Roman cavalry, to prevent those who camped around Jerusalem from aiding those who were in the temple. And so the revolt started up on the Temple Mount. Now the cavalry killed about 3,000 men, but the rest went up into the hills that lay nearby. So they just took off. So Archelaus proclaimed that everyone return to your homes. When he proclaimed it, it's like, okay, here's the order. Everyone go home, even those who were venturesome from lack of education, even the stupid people left the Feast of Passover, giving it up in fear of greater harm. So the warning went out, you stick around here, you're dead. Everyone took off, even the slowest mentally challenged person left. There's no way that they're gonna stick around because they saw the bloodbath that ensued. And so now incident 26, we read Matthew 2:19. We continue on, picking it right back up. When Herod was dead, the angel of Yahovah appeared in a dream to Yosef saying, "Rise up, take the young child's mother, return to the land of Israel, for those who sought the child's life are dead." Okay, now that is a repeat of what we read in incident number 25, and then, you know, then I inserted what Archelaus did so that now you get the context of what's transpiring here. So Yosef arose, took the child and his mother, returned to the land of Israel. But when he heard that Archelaus reigned in Judea in the place of his father Herod, and again, you see Archelaus reigned in place of his father. Now you see what happened when he reigned in the place of his father because of Josephus's record. Now it makes sense the rest of this verse. Yosef was afraid to go there. He was also warned in a dream to go around Judea and into the region of the Gentiles. So he went up to live in the village of Nazareth, thus fulfilled that which is spoken by the prophets, he shall be called a Netzer, a Netzer. Now, of course, we dealt with this in the introduction and also last week, what it means to be a Netzer, which is an agricultural term referring only to an olive tree, and a Netzer is a shoot that shoots forth from the original root system of an olive tree, but shoots up much distant from the original trunk and at a much later time. The original trunk may even have been cut down for lack of fruitfulness, but yet it comes up. These are available to see just about in every olive yard around the land of Israel, and especially over on the side of the Mount of Olives, there are olive trees over there, 2,000 years old, the original stump just almost decayed, still standing, but then out of the side, somewhat distant, shoots forth another one, and this one may be 300 years old, where the original one was 2,000 years old, but it's a Netzer. It shot up on the original system of the root of Yishai at a later time and distant from the original trunk. That's why it's a village of Netzarim, from the offspring of Yishai, the father of David. So note number 5, General Varus suppresses the Jewish revolt. Rome sends General Varus from Syria to quell the riots revolting from Archelaus's Passover massacre. Now this occurred when Archelaus was in Rome, that he sent, General Varus was sent, and he was in Rome because he's trying to secure his father's throne and to answer for some of these brash actions. So again, we quote from the Antiquities of the Jews by Josephus, when Archelaus sailed off for Rome and Varus went to take care of Antioch, Antioch named after Antiochus Epiphanes, the Syrian Greek general who put a statue of Zeus on the temple, declaring Zeus to be God. It says that Sabinus advanced on Jerusalem and took the king's possessions. And then, again, he writes, but Varus sent part of his army around the countryside seeking those to blame for the revolt. And when they were pointed out, he punished those who were guilty. So you got Jews that are now ratting on each other, trying to figure out who's doing it. There were also those who were pardoned, but 2,000 happened to be crucified because of his accusation. And how were they crucified? They were crucified on Roman crosses. The word for cross in Greek is staros, but that doesn't really matter because you take a look at what the word is in Hebrew as we go back to staros and the Septuagint and all, and it is translated as tree, it's translated as wood. It's literally wood. That's all it is. And according to the context and according to the culture, that determines how someone is hung on wood. In Persia, they were perched on top of a pointed stake, okay? They were seated upon it, and this pointed stake got bigger and bigger and bigger, and the point went up further and further and further until they died an excruciating, excruciating death. The Romans, however, used a different method. When the Romans conquered Persia, they took on the worship of Mithra. Mithra was the Persian version of the Babylonian Tammuz. Tammuz, born on December 25th. Mithra, born on December 25th. Constantine was a worshiper of Sol Invictus Mithra, the invincible sun Mithra, to the day of his death. Mithra's birthday, take a look at it, December 25th. It's in every Encyclopedia Britannica Junior out there. And, you know, this is the time of the winter solstice on the ancient Babylonian calendar before the precession of the equinoxes, okay? December, Deca, the 10th month, even though it's a 12th month on the pagan calendar, on the ancient Babylonian calendar, we go back in time, it is the 10th month. And the 25th day, that is the time of the winter solstice, the rebirth of the sun. And so, this is the, when Rome conquered Persia, then the Roman soldiers took on the worship of Mithra and put the battle standard of Mithra, which was the cross, the Babylonian towel or cross, on their flags, their battle standards, on their shields. This was 100 years before the birth of Yeshua. The cross was decorating the battle standards of the Roman army. You see, in the, in your calendar this year, Arc de Triomphe in Orange, France. Just happened to be driving through Orange, France, took a wrong turn, and came upon the Arc de Triomphe, and there was the cross on the shields of battle standards, and the Arc de Triomphe was built 100 years before the birth of Yeshua, because the sign of the cross, the sign of Mithra, this is how, what they used to crucify people, they hung them as a sacrifice to their god, Sol Invictus Mithra. And so, you know, those who want to try to make a big deal that Jesus was hung on a tree, because an English version of the Bible says tree, and so now they got to get a tree with branches and leaves on it. It's like, you know, it's idiocy. We have to take a look at what is going on culturally. They crucified 2,000 people. Joseph said they had 2,000 people. They had men waiting in chains, up to a week waiting for the next cross to become available, because sometimes it took a week to be tortured to death on the cross of Mithra. That's what they used. So, this is the Jewish revolt that happened. This is why Yosef took Miriam and Yeshua and went not to Bethlehem. We're staying a long ways away from what Archelaus is doing. We want nothing to do with this. People are being hung by the thousands on Roman crosses. They just said they ran out of wood. They didn't have enough wood to build crosses with. You know, wood's not a real common thing in Israel. You know, they use wood to help build arches of stone, and then they take the wood out and reuse it. They use them for forms, the same way that we build in Israel today. When you build a house, yeah, we use wood. We use wood for the forms, for the concrete, for the stone and all. But once you get it in place, then you take the wood and you reuse it, and you're going to build 20 houses with that same 2x4. You're going to have that same 2x4 for the entire duration of when you are building as an adult male. Nothing different in ancient Israel. Now, here's Luke's third summary statement, incident number 27. Yeshua grows up in Netzaret. The child grew and was strengthened in spirit, says in Luke chapter 2, verse 40. He was filled with wisdom, and the grace of Yahovah was upon him. He grew, Oksano grew up. He grew and was strengthened in spirit, filled with wisdom, and the grace of Yahovah was upon him. What is grace? Grace is divine empowerment, is to do, and Yeshua, having never, ever violated the Torah, not as a child, not as a young adult, never. Because if he ever violated the Torah, then he would be in sin, because sin is the violation of the Torah. You can break the rules and regulation of man all you desire to do, all you can get away with, but that is not sin. Sin is violating the Torah of God. Now, when the rules of man and the rules of the Torah are the same, then if you violate the rules of man, then you're violating the Torah, and that is sin. But religion basically is built on the rules of man superseding the rules of the Torah, and that is not the way it is. The Torah is a rule of law for all of eternity, all of eternity. It never is going to pass away. It's never going to become null or void. The Torah is eternal. This is Yeshua's message. Obey Moses. Do not obey the doctrines and commandments of men. Violate them. If his spirit is in you, you will do what he did. You will torch them up. You will violate the rules and regulations to show that they have no authority. You are free. You shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free. And Yeshua was free, lived free all of his life, but was never free from the Torah. Now, incident number 28, and this is the culminating moment of everything that we have read. Yeshua goes up to Jerusalem for Passover. Aliyah, what is in Hebrew. Yeshua astonishes the Torah scholars gathered at Jerusalem for the feast. This is Passover, which is the 15th through the 21st day of the first month. It is 4010 from creation. It is 10 of the common error. Luke 2:41, we read. Every year, Yeshua's parents went up to Jerusalem for the Passover. When he was 12 years old, they all went up to Jerusalem according to the commandment. So here it is, time for him to go up, and according to the commandment, he goes up. So when they had fulfilled the days of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, so they're there, you know, would get there for, you know, ideally they would be there by the 9th. They'd be there for the selection of the Passover lamb when it's paraded into the city by the high priest. Everyone would have their palm fronds and they would welcome them in. Hosanna in the highest, blessed is he that comes in the name of the Lord. And the high priest brings the Passover lamb in that he has chosen from the sheepfolds of Bethlehem on a scarlet cord, brings them up to the Temple Mount, stakes them on the Temple Mount, where for the next 4 days, everyone in the nation is obligated, it's their joy, it's their privilege to inspect that lamb, to see that it's the most perfect lamb, the most perfect in conformity in every way, and at the end of those 4 days, on the morning of the 14th, when the Passover lambs are to be sacrificed that afternoon, the high priest makes his final inspection and says, I find no fault in him. So they would be up there for the entire period of time. And then the sacrifice of all the Passover lambs, Josephus said, about 250,000 Passover lambs were sacrificed, which means that's a lamb for a household, and if your household isn't big enough, other people join in. That's why Josephus calculated about 2.5 million people going up to the feast because of the number of Passover lambs that were sacrificed. Other people estimate it much lower. The lowest I've ever heard is 800,000, which is the population of the greater Jerusalem area to this day. And think of the mass transit system, the railways, the buses, everything else, the traffic jams that it takes to take care of 800,000 people. Think of what it was like back in Yeshua's day. 800,000 people, let's jack it up to 2.5 million people. Let's try to get all those people in Jerusalem for these festivities, for the triumphal entry of the Passover lamb. I'll tell you, Hollywood never could afford the extras to do even a shadow of this. They couldn't even do this with CG computer graphics, ladies and gentlemen. This was something beyond the imagination, what was going on in Jerusalem at this time. And so, they were up there for that. The Passover lambs were sacrificed. The householders brought them back. Yosef, the stepfather of Yeshua, would have gone up there, sacrificed the lamb, and brought him back. Yeshua very likely would have gone up there to be a part of this whole thing. And then the last lamb that was sacrificed was the one that was selected by the high priest from the sheepfolds of Bethlehem. And after they had sung the song of ascent several times through, as they are taking the blood of the animals, splashing them on the altar, passing the bowls back around, and when that's all done, the last Passover lamb, the sacrifice, the high priest would then wet his lips and make the final cry, it is finished. Then the householders taking all the lambs back, the high priest and his entourage would then take the lamb down into the priest quarters in Mount Moriah, in the Temple Mount itself, put the lamb to roast, and then they would go over with their entourage to the Mount of Olives, across the bridge, the Mount of Olives, where they would bind together 10 standing omer of barley. And they would shock it all together and then leave and go back. During the next days until the sun went down at the end of the weekly Sabbath during the feast, which could have been even 6 days from then, that particular year. We don't know, I didn't even calculate it, what it would have been that year. That'd be interesting. I'm gonna make a note. Day. Because it's all calculatable. I can tell you exactly what day it was. I just didn't bother doing it. I don't know why I didn't think of it. Just one detail that is absolutely worthless, except for the fact that we can calculate it, so why not be completely anal retentive? I have been on everything else in this this book to get every detail that I can think of that you may be able to derive something from. Chronology is important. But anyway, after the weekly Sabbath, when the sun sets, that's when the high priest and his entourage go back over the Kidron Valley Bridge after the setting of the sun. They then harvest the first fruits of the barley, bring it back over the Temple Mount. They process it, they winnow it, they parch it, they grind it, they bake it, and then it's presented the next morning as the first fruits in the temple service. That is what transpires. They were there for this entire thing, the Feast of Unleavened Bread, for the entire duration. Of course, after the first fruit offering is offered, then they can eat the new barley of the land, and not until then, but at that point, they can eat the new barley of the land, and so by the end of the feast, they are eating unleavened bread with new barley cakes made from the barley of this year's harvest. And so when they had fulfilled, verse 43, the days of unleavened bread, they returned home, but Yeshua tarried in Jerusalem, and Joseph and his mother did not realize it. They went a day's journey, supposing he had been among the caravan before they began searching for him among their relatives and neighbors. Now, I have to understand what's going on here. The entire village of Netzaret, which at this time could have well been around 300 to 500 people. The village would go together, they would travel together up to the feast. The children would be playing together and walking along. It's not like everyone has to hold mommy and daddy's hands. It's the entire village, the old people, the young people, everyone's traveling together. Everyone's watching over each other. And so they go up to the feast together. They camp together on the way up. You know, it's a 3-day journey, you know, reasonably from Netzaret to get to the feast at Jerusalem. And so, you know, there's camping along the way. It's fun, it's festivities the whole way. Now they get there, the feast is over, and everyone is heading back. They're all in the group, they're all packing up, everyone's ready, and Yeshua's there, but then he's not there. Nobody knows, nobody even notices that he's not there. But, you know, he has been in the temple during this period of time, and we're gonna see what transpires here, because all of a sudden, they traveled an entire day, and it just hasn't come to mind because it's not an issue. The kids watch over each other and they're all traveling together. So when they began searching for him among their relatives and neighbors, when they couldn't find him, they returned to Jerusalem and began seeking him there. Now I added the word immediately in there. They immediately returned to Jerusalem because put yourself in their place. They leave Jerusalem. They're gonna leave early in the morning, okay? Maybe even before sunrise. They go all the way back, they're heading back, they spend the whole day, and in the evening, they're setting up camp, and they say, where's Yeshua? Look around, nobody's seen him all day long. Now, they're responsible for the Son of Almighty God, all right? They left him, they didn't check, he's not there. Do you think that they get a good night's sleep and took back at their leisure the next day? Normally you don't travel at night, but I will guarantee you, if I'm in charge of Yeshua and I realize I left him behind, I am going to be walking in the, again, you know, we've got, you know, after a few hours, we're gonna have not too much past a full moon. We're gonna have a half a moon up there. That's what we've got. Half a moon, I'm gonna be able to see, I'm gonna be traveling all night long to get back there. I arrive the next morning and I am scouring the place. It says, now verse 46, finally, After 3 days, and I add of searching, because they're not on a picnic, people, they are desperate. Their heart is in their throat every single moment. What has happened to him? They found him. After 3 days of diligent search, they found him sitting in the temple amongst the Torah sages, listening to them and asking them questions. Everyone that heard him was astonished at his understanding and at his answers. Astonished at his existemi, which is completely outside of the mind. He absolutely blew their mind. And these are the Torah sages of this generation. But when at last his parents found him, they were amazed, and his mother said, "Son, why have you dealt with us this way? Look at us. Your father and I have searched for you with great anguish." Yeshua replied, "How is it that you sought me?" How? He didn't say why. He said, "How? You traveled all night to get here. You spent 3 days. What method did you use? Did you think I was down playing at the playground? Did you think I was out fishing? Where were you looking for me? Did it not occur to you that it behooved me to be in my father's house?" King James says, "About my father's business." The word business is not even there. It's in his father's house. Why didn't you look for me here? You took off. I went back. There was nobody there. What did you expect me to do? I went right back to my father's house. I have not left here. I slept here. The priest took care of me. They made sure I had something to eat. I was taken care of. How is it that you are looking for me? They didn't fully understand what he was telling them, Yeshua. So Yeshua went down from Jerusalem with them, returned to Nazareth, and was obedient to them. His mother quietly kept all these things in her heart. This is all that needs to be said about Yeshua. He is with the most brilliant Torah sages of his day. And the questions he asked and the answers he gave was existemi, completely outside of their mind. They were stunned. How does he understand this? I have been studying this for 60 years, and I never saw this. I had no idea. I am so embarrassed. This child just laid this thing out. I feel like a fool. Parents followed him and said, "How are you looking for me? Didn't you know I'd be here? Look for me for 3 days? I'm glad you finally showed up. I was beginning to worry about you." And now, here's the final summary, Luke's fourth summary statement, the final summary statement in section one. Yeshua matures into a young man in Nazareth. This is Luke's fourth summary statement, Luke 2:52, and Yeshua increased in wisdom and in stature and in favor of Yahovah and man. So it's very similar to the summary statement in Luke 2:40. The child grew and was strengthened in spirit. He was filled with wisdom, and the grace of Yahovah was upon him. Now after this incident, and Yeshua increased in wisdom, completely blowing the mind of the greatest sages of his day, and yet he increased in wisdom. He grew in stature and in favor with Yahovah and man. Nobody could find any fault with him. He was absolutely obedient. He obeyed his parents. He kept the Torah. There was no question. Everyone was impressed with this young man. Now we don't have to say another word about him. We don't have to make up stories that he killed his teacher because he disagreed with him, or he sunk other little boys' boats and other stupid stuff like that. No, this is so far beyond the greatest wisdom of the sages of the ages. You don't need to say anything else. If anything else is said, we wouldn't even be able to comprehend it. If we listened to what he said, we wouldn't even have any idea. We would just have to say, I'm an idiot. That's all I can say. I'm a complete moron. But see, we're so ignorant. We don't even, you know, we shouldn't even be asking the question, well, what else did he do? No. Because we are too slow to ever comprehend it. Well, this is the prophet. This is the prophet, Yeshua, the Messiah. As he grows up in stature, as he increases more and more wisdom, and the next thing we're gonna see, section one, is Yeshua's mikvah. Well, thank you for being with us again. Looking forward to getting into Yeshua's ministry and the detail of this step-by-step. Thank you for staying with me, and we'll see you again in our 2 weeks from now in our next Wednesday night Bible study. This is Michael Rood bidding you shalom, peace. Now, I'd like to pray. Yivarechecha Yehovah v'yishmorecha, ayir panavelecha v'chinecha. Yisa Yehovah panavelecha v'yisamlecha shalom, v'shem Yeshua HaMashiach, sar shalom. Yehovah bless you and keep you, may face shine upon you, may Yehovah lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Shalom. Lehitzor. Bye-bye.
The iron hand, it ain't no match for the iron rod. The strongest wall will crumble and fall to a mighty God. For all those who have eyes and all those who have ears, it is only He who can reduce me to tears. Don't you cry and don't you die and don't you burn like a thief in the night. He'll replace wrong with right when he returns.
Hey, where do you think you're going? You're not done yet. You gotta subscribe if you wanna see more of this stuff. Just click the button up here. Better yet, you can click here to watch more right now. And if you like what you see, support what we do. Donate here to keep the broadcast coming. Thank you.